Hi everyone, thanks for coming to .NET Knots. This month it's sponsored by Cordius, the recruiters that usually sit over there. So if you do need a job, go and see those recruiters and they might be able to find one. But they're not here this month, but they are paying for the pizza and beer again. Tonight we've got Martin, who's going to talk about Apache Cordova. And over to you, Martin.
Thank you very much.
Hello everybody.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello. I'm here. This is quite a risk, because last night I sent an email saying I'm not sure if I'm going to be able to do this talk because my machine blue screened, which is ironic, being from Microsoft and all. But I've got I've managed to rebuild a machine. I've managed to get everything set up, and hopefully we will be able to go through everything I was hoping to show you. How many people have used Apache Cordova at all? One. It's really good then. There's going to be some stuff that I might go over for you particularly, but if you want to call out anything that I've got wrong, then by all means.
When I developed something and it was actually before the Node.js stuff, so it was actually it was a couple of years back. So
right.
Okay. A few things about this is quite new. So I've been installing this plugin out and just having a slot. Ooh.
It's there.
That's all I've done, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, Apache Cordova. This is my PowerPoint, by the way, today. Purely because my PowerPoint doesn't work on this machine at the moment either. This is Insider's Fast Ring, whatever version of Windows 10, which just got released on Sunday, which is completely ballsing up my machine. Now, I'm on Fast Ring, so it should be, that does mean that I expect it to balls up. That's the point of Fast Ring. But I never actually expect it to balls up, which is disappointing. So, sadly, my presentation is purely going to be inside of an application called OneNote today and Visual Studio rather than PowerPoint. So, these are my notes, really. Rather than having them on slide format, as ordinarily I would, I've just written them down 10 minutes ago because I couldn't get PowerPoint to be stable enough to last the whole talk. So Apache Cordova is kind of a bit of a, for me at least, it's something I've been using for about 3 years on and off. And we speak to lots of companies about applications nowadays at Microsoft. So when Windows Phone 7 got launched, we first got into the kind of apps business, really, of going to people and speaking to them about kind of apps which would be or compete with iPad applications. And we were speaking to CIOs and journalists about our new platform and so forth. And there seems to be a trend, at least, amongst many people, which says that the web is dead and that applications are the new vogue. That's the thing that people are going to be developing, and it's not going to be the web. Some people claim the web is dead. And it's interesting because I think that the web absolutely is not dead. And it's capable, in fact, of everything that native application platforms are in almost all cases. And things like Apache Cordova are somewhat of a stopgap between browser manufacturers competing directly head-on with application platforms. And I think that lots of companies have got this problem at the moment where they don't really have the skills necessary to build for two platforms, for both in Java and Objective-C. They don't really want to set up two different teams to do those things. And they want to build once and then customize in many places. They want to have different experiences across different devices for different customers, but they don't really want to have two separate development teams. And the majority of big apps today do have two separate development teams. They don't. It's very rare that you see a development team which will be both doing Objective-C and Java. So you usually have for example, if we take Yammer, for instance, in our own company, we have a Windows Phone team, we have an Android team and an iOS team. And they work on different, schedules. They have different features which are required for both teams. And there's lots of feature disparity between platforms, even though they've got quite a lot of resources to manage this. And so if people like Yammer are finding it difficult to manage three platforms, then how can kind of regular application builders or people which have only got a 2 or 3 man team to build applications, how could they possibly to do this? It becomes very expensive. We traditionally were seeing when we were going in with apps for Windows Phone 7 that applications cost around £50,000 for a platform. So when you would go to an agency or a company or a bunch of developers and you ask them to build an application, traditionally the price that would come back would be about £50,000 to build an application. Because applications used to be a one-off thing that you would build once, you'd put into a store, then you'd forget about. Maybe you'd update it after 6 months. But over the last 2 or 3 years, we're starting to see most applications, major applications at least, are shipping to the store or the various app stores, are built every single day. So Yammer, for example, they do continuous integration. They build a single build every single day. They send over to Apple every single day. I think I just want to kind of say that I think that the kind of web development has a real place to play in making this a much better environment to build applications. And Apache Cordova is kind of the thing which can help compete or help the web compete against apps currently. So fundamentally, we're talking about hybrid applications. Hybrid applications means mixing native applications with web technologies. There's a number of different ways you can do it. You can have a really basic idea of taking your current website or your current web application and wrapping it in something to make it puttable in the store, which isn't possibly the best way of doing it, but that's a simple way. We call that the hosted web app. It's a hybrid form of hybrid application. And then more traditionally, like what most hybrid Apache Cordova applications are for, is actually building applications, but building a JavaScript against a common API, which runs across all platforms and uses native features. So when we ask people why they choose Cordova, they predominantly say familiarity with language, because it's cross-platform. There is a performance thing that they want to get across from by you building against Cordova rather than just building in the web. There's a performance benefit that you can get from building those kinds of applications. It's got great plugins. It's open standard, of course. It's very cheap to get involved. There's a low barrier to entry. You could build Cordova stuff just at command line. You don't need any special tools to get started. And when we were going in with Windows Phone 7 bids at the start, they were saying £50,000 the average application. Nowadays, most applications we ask to get built, or the price that comes back is about £200,000 that they want for an application per platform. So if a major application is looking to build for three platforms, then the bill is probably going to be around £500,000 or somewhere in that region for a major application, at least. And if you've got to build it three times, it's £200,000 times three. Whereas if you can use something like Cordova or Xamarin or a cross-platform tool, then potentially you could use that £200,000, and build all the applications across all the different platforms. It's a compromise, and if you hear anyone say that building hybrid applications isn't a compromise, then they're lying to you. It's definitely a compromise. There's always performance gains currently in the current state of play. If you're trying to just go for pure outperformance, then native applications will always win. But for the vast majority of applications, hybrid applications could solve the problem for most people and do it at a much cheaper rate. So Cordova has become the most popular one. It used to be called PhoneGap, by the way, if you're not familiar with the horrible name of Apache Cordova. PhoneGap was an open source project which then got bought by Adobe. Adobe were really nice about how they acquired the company, and they open sourced PhoneGap, as they called it, PhoneGap then. They renamed the open source project Apache Cordova, and then they have their own set of tools and their own build process called PhoneGap. That still exists, it's like a brand name, but that PhoneGap is effectively Adobe's version of Apache Cordova, and a very good version of Apache Cordova it is. And they have a whole build system, SDK, platform, runtime, everything built around it. But Apache Cordova is kind of like the glue which sticks all of these, enables you to build the basics of these applications. Microsoft have built one of these frameworks which rely on Apache Cordova, but there's lots of other companies as well. IBM have built one, Telrec have built one. Pretty much anyone which is in the space of mobile applications or mobile UI has built something which relies on Apache Cordova. So about 3 years ago, the Visual Studio team looked at Apache Cordova and built a proof of type beta, which landed in Visual Studio 2013. And it worked and it ran. It had a few limitations though. For one, when you were building in Visual Studio 2013 for Apache Cordova, once you kind of started using Visual Studio, you couldn't then take it off of Visual Studio and then just build it at command line very easily. It added all sorts of project stuff, like Visual Studio does. It kind of, to make it part of Visual Studio and to add better tooling support, it kind of added lots of stuff in, which made it then difficult for people which weren't necessarily using Visual Studio to also collaborate on the same project. And what we found that some people were using Visual Studio to build these applications, Apache Cordova applications, but some people on their team might not be using Visual Studio. And actually that workflow was quite difficult in 2013. In 2015, the Apache Cordova stuff that you see inside of Visual Studio is Apache Cordova. It's vanilla Apache Cordova. you could take the output of the project or the project folder and just run it in some command line if you wish. There's nothing, apart from the addition of a JSON file, a taco.json file, there's really no changes to the project at all. What Visual Studio is trying to do, though, is add in productivity benefits to the platform. At the moment, if you don't use something like Visual Studio or you don't use something like PhoneGap, you're kind of in command line, running commands, which is fine for some people, but it's quite a painful workflow. A lot of that can be automated and so forth. But I guess the automation part is, and the tooling part is what people like Visual Studio, what IBM and all these companies are trying to add onto it. So if you're thinking about cross-platform, Cordova might be one thing that you're thinking about, but there's lots of, at Microsoft, there's lots of options. We have Xamarin, of course. It's using C-sharp, going to cross-platform. And there's a great website called Property Cross, propertycross.com. And what they do is they take an application, a property application, so like sales listing of house listings and stuff, like a bit like a an estate agent, online estate agent website. And they build the app in every known cross-platform technology known to man. So everything, so from DevXtreme, Enyo, Intel App Framework, JTouch, Kendo UI, Lungo, SensureTouch, Ionic, Famous, Emmy, all of the nouns that you've heard, but probably very few people have actually used in much detail. It's also compiled to native applications like Air, Delphi, Neomad, Rio Mobile, Xamarin, CrossLite. And they take the same application and they implement it in all of the different technologies, then give you the source code. So if you're trying to evaluate as a team lead which cross-platform technology to choose for an application, it's a great site to start with because they've built a basically proof-of-concept application and you can see the benefits and disbenefits of those kind of ways. The other thing, I'm hoping they've still got, they've actually updated their website, but so if we take, for example, actually, is Apache Cordova, something like Ionic, using Apache Cordova. They talk about the implementation, they talk about the related links to it, any issues that they found. They then give you screen grabs of what the output application looks like on iOS and on Android. And if we look at Xamarin again, it shows you what Android and iOS look like and there's differences between the frameworks. Because actually cross-platform, there's arguments for and against this, but when you're thinking about building cross-platform applications, you don't really just want to have a write once, run anywhere kind of application. You want it to kind of augment the device's capabilities and design aesthetics. And most of the good frameworks here do something to make it feel more integrated into the device rather than just an application which just so happens to technically run on that device. It actually feels like part of that device. So it's good to look at this, see the source code, and evaluate which framework might be for you. So where are we? So fundamentally, what is Cordova? Cordova builds on the idea that almost every app platform has a web view. So if we imagine over here, we have an application platform. I'll do the silhouette, you never know what platform that might be. That's a mobile phone device with a screen. Good drawing there. They all have a web view, so this is a web view right here. And what we have on all these devices is web view and a native platform as well. And what Apache Cordova does on every platform, and it has to do it in different ways for each platform, is it creates a common abstraction layer between the web view and the native APIs. You as a developer just code to JavaScript APIs, which have been abstracted, so they ultimately call down into native APIs using plugins. So if you want to get access to the accelerometer of the device, then you do it through a JavaScript API, and if the browser has implemented some way of doing accelerometer, then it will use that way of doing accelerometer, but if it hasn't, someone will write a native kind of bridge, a native piece of code which exposes JavaScript APIs, And then they have a mechanism of calling those native call, those native APIs from the web view. So really, Apache Cordova, it's bridging that gap between a web view and the native view. And that's why it was called PhoneGap, because it's the gap between the two, the web view and the native platform. So you end up as a developer programming purely in JavaScript, but sometimes calling browser APIs and sometimes calling into native APIs. probably cross we'll have a look at that. So if we go over to Visual Studio's website, when you install Visual Studio 2015, and this is in the free version of our tools as well, it's inside of Visual Studio Express. You can build, and there's no difference between the version in Express and the version in, say, Enterprise. The tools which are actually installed are exactly the same. They have all the same capabilities. It adds into Visual Studio as kind of a plugin, and it's part of the install procedure. So when you install Visual Studio, it will say, do you want to install Apache Cordova tools? It will be ticked by default to install it. And it will install the set of tools which just make it easy inside of Visual Studio to create Apache Cordova tools. Interestingly, it will install some rather exotic software onto your machine, exotic from a Microsoft point of view. For example, we will install Google Chrome on your machine for you. We will install iTunes on your machine for you. Because these Chrome is required for the emulator called Ripple. It only works in Chrome. It doesn't work in any other browser. So we have to have Chrome installed on the target machine. So if you don't have it, in the unlikely event, we'll install it. Also, iTunes, we do live debugging to Macs. So you are able inside of Visual Studio to build an Apache Cordova application, deploy it to an iPad or iPhone, or a real iPad or iPhone, on a Mac via a network, and then live debug the application on those real devices. But to be able to do that, we have to tap into the Bonjour network protocol, so we have to install iTunes. So there's lots of things that we install in that install which you would not see ordinarily in a Microsoft install package. All the greatest software from our biggest competitors. It's interesting. So you install, download Visual Studio. If you untick the box to install Apache Cordova tools, you can reinstall them. If you go to File New Project, it might have an install button. They take from a vanilla instance of Visual Studio 2015 to install Apache Cordova tools. It takes a while. We install an Android emulator as well, so we also install a version of Android which we have forked on your machine. We have the Android emulator which comes with our tools is ridiculously faster than the one which Google will install part of their tools. So we've got a great, if you don't even use an Apache Cordova and you just want to use an Android emulator for Java development, we've got a really great emulator which starts much, much faster than the one which Google ships. It's as performant as the most popular emulator, which is by a company called Grey Matter. Anyway, so install all these things. It takes about 30 to 40 minutes. It's quite a big install. There's lots of stuff. I think it takes about 12 gigs worth of stuff because there's emulators, virtual machines, all sorts of things that come down to make the tooling experience complete. So that's what the install thing looks like, and you'll get this kind of HTML JavaScript. Can I edit this? No. Stuff like this never works very well when you are presenting mode. So I think it's over here. HTML JavaScript Apache Cordova update 1. So that will be installed by default. And then you are basically writing JavaScript code. All of your code that you write for an Apache Cordova application will generally be in JavaScript. The only time that you'll have to slip into either Java or Objective-C is if you want to write your own plugin. Because you might find that there's not a plugin which already exists which does a thing that you need to do on a device. For example, maybe Apple have shipped a brand new API to the platform and no one's yet created a plugin for it. But you need it for your application. Maybe something to do with biometrics, or maybe it's something specific to that device. You could write well-documented approaches to this. You could write the Objective-C to create a plugin, or the Swift code for that matter, to write a plugin for iOS, expose it as JavaScript, and then have that be installed inside your application. So then you could call it via JavaScript APIs. But generally speaking, most PhoneGap and most Apache Cordova developers don't write Java or Objective-C. They're using it, but they're using plugins which other people have written. So inside of Visual Studio, you're going to benefit from things like IntelliSense when writing JavaScript. So as you're typing known projects and known types, that you'll get good IntelliSense about what the objects can do and so forth. It's good JavaScript syntax highlighting. And you can use things like you would ordinarily use in JavaScript in C#, like go to definition or code peeking and things like that inside of Visual Studio. So all the tools which are available for C# are also available there. You've got this concept that you can plug an Android device into a Windows machine and debug an Apache Cordova application on an Android device. You can debug on a Windows Phone device, because Apache Cordova supports Windows Phone and Windows. You can debug and deploy to iPhones and iPads and Macs. But to do that portion of it, you have to have a Mac. So you can't, Visual Studio doesn't come with a built-in Mac. It requires you to have a Mac on the network to do the actual build. We actually secretly do have a way of doing that, but it's illegal, so we can't actually ship the product. It requires, to actually do the build process on Mac, you have to have a specific license for Mac, so we can't yet do that. If you haven't got a Mac but you want to test it on an iPhone, you can use a cloud Macing service like Macing Cloud, who run Mac servers, and they actually have Xamarin and Apache Cordova tools installed. Macing Cloud is basically, they boot up a Mac for you in their data center, and then you remote into it, and you get the full screen experience of it. And you connect it to your Visual Studio, and then you can debug live over the internet onto Macing Cloud. If you're serious about iPhone and thingy development, though, just use a Mac. So, but it can get you out of a scrape if you don't have a Mac available and a Windows machine is all you've got, and you need to debug on iPad and iPhone. So yeah, it will connect over a network port, and you'll be able to debug live on an iPad or an iPhone. Debugging works exactly the same as you'd expect in any kind of Visual Studio application. You put breakpoints in, they get hit, you can step over, step into, look at variables, all the sorts of things that you can do with debugging, regularly debugging. We have a concept called plugins. Whenever you're inside of an application and it needs a capability, you would often use a plugin. So things like really common scenarios, like you want to access the camera, there's a plugin for the camera that you'll need to enable. And by enabling that, you're giving permission for that application to use the camera. But pretty much anything which is an interaction with the device, which isn't supported by web standards, you're going to have to call into plugins. The last thing that we also have is we have an Azure service called Mobile App Service, which we've made it very easy to integrate with a Cordova application. That's one of their kind of things that they're doing. So you can right-click and create a back-end for your application pretty simply for Visual Studio. And then the last point is we actually are committers to Apache Cordova. So there's about 10 or so developers which, on a daily basis at Microsoft, their job is to commit to the Apache Cordova project. And basically, I guess the majority of the stuff that we're trying to do is bug fixes, stability fixes, and support for Windows platforms as well. So we're doing a lot of the making sure that Apache Cordova supports Windows forms really well, Windows applications and development devices are really well.
They're committed to the open source project.
They committed directly to the open source project, yeah. So we're committers to that, the open source, to the Apache Cordova public Git repo. So let's have a look. So if we just go into Visual Studio, and I'll do a file new project, you will have this template installed by default, blank app Apache Cordova, or you'll have something which prompts you to install the tools if you haven't got the tools installed. So it's inside the JavaScript folder, Apache Cordova applications, blank app Apache Cordova. This is the fourth application I've created on this machine since this morning. So we press OK. And what this will do is it should create a brand new project. And this particular project has a very good README. We have lots of READMEs inside of Visual Studio, which are usually just closed down and never read. But this one's particularly good in that if you're brand new to to Apache Cordova, it tells you everything you need to know to get up and running. But in time-honored tradition, I'm just going to close that and ignore it. And look at this here, which is the project file, the project layout that we've got. So if we look at the project layout, we have a couple of folders in there. One which shows our dependencies, the merges folder, a resources folder, a www folder, a bower.json, build.json, config.xaml, package.json, the product readme, which we just closed down, and this taco.json. The only thing really which is there which you wouldn't necessarily see in a regular Cordova application, so if you went to, did it from command line and did an npm install Cordova, then started running Cordova things, it would build this project folder basically, but it wouldn't include that last one, which is taco.json. And that is tools for Apache Cordova. So it's the Visual Studio's, that's basically the Visual Studio part of this thing. So there's a few concepts in there which might be new. Because Bower is a dependency, a package manager, which we're using in the next version of .NET as well. So if you if you're using anything in ASP.NET Core, you'll see this Bower project coming up a lot. If you're a Java developer, a Node developer, you will also use Bower. And it's basically a way of getting third-party client libraries. So if you wanted to install Angular or jQuery or anything like that, you wouldn't go to NuGet and get those things. You would go to Bower. So this is what a Bower file looks like. And basically, you're able to add in the dependencies for your application. So if you were going to use Angular, you could add Angular in here as a dependency to your application. And that is the Bower bird, by the way. We just put that there. God knows why, because we could. Someone was bored one day. So if we want to add Angular to our application, we would just click on write Angular, and then I'll take any version of it. Basically, as I'm typing this, you'll see that it's doing a live call to the Bower repository, and we're getting, it faded out just as I was doing it there. But you can sort of, maybe you can't see it, but let's just see if I can. See, they're all of the JavaScript libraries inside of Bower. And my favorite game at the moment using Bower is called guessanoun.js. So pick a noun. Anyone got a noun for me? Beer. Beer. There is a JavaScript framework called Beer. You can install it. I think it's only required that you install it. Anything else like Nottingham?
Request.
A request is going to be in there, sure. But basically, it's quite hard to find a noun.
Find mine.
All right.
Sorry.
What is that? That hijack my presentation? Does it?
Yeah, sorry about that.
No. I mean, I'll install it and then it will just take over my machine or something like that. That'd be quite smart. But yeah.
If I'd have thought that far ahead.
Yeah, exactly.
That's absolutely awesome.
I'm gonna do that. Someone else. but basically, a note. You know, Bower is basically the client-side dependency management system for web, full stop. So that's why we're using it in ASP.NET Core, and it's already commonly used inside of Apache Cordova anyway. So if you want to install Angular, jQuery, Ionic, or any of the other JavaScript frameworks, and there are, as we've just discovered, many, many of them, then you would do it through Bower. I'm going to have no dependencies for this particular thing at the moment. So if I just start this application, I'm going to use a thing called Ripple. And to be honest, Ripple is infinitely frustrating. Ripple is the emulator for Apache Cordova applications. And it's meant to be like the emulator that you're supposed to develop against. I find it really flaky. So I don't use it to develop against it, but it's important to just know what it is and have a look at it, because lots of people do use Ripple. This is why we have to install Chrome, because it's a Chrome-only capability. It only supports Chrome, so you can't use Firefox, you can't use Microsoft Edge. And this is actually the reason why, this particular reason right now, is why I don't like Ripple, because it does this a lot. I don't quite know why.
So Ripple's an emulator.
So Ripple is an emulator. You'd see it once it comes up. very much. Yeah, I'll wait.
You mentioned that Microsoft had done their own emulator.
Yeah.
To be used instead of.
Yeah. I'll show you the workflow that I use. You can use we have an Android emulator. So if you need to test it on Android, we have an Android emulator, which is a real Android distribution, which we can run against. But yes, it would be far better than this to use that.
This is just a generic emulator.
Yeah, and it has troubles specifically on it's got some kind of problem with the network. What I'm going to do is perhaps quite stupid. Have you got the password for this wireless network?
Yeah. Same one.
I'm just going to disconnect it just in case, and then restart it because it does because that's how you fix that problem. I don't quite know what the issue is. It's something to do with firewalls. It's something to do with when I'm on networks presenting. It never works, so I just have to disconnect from network, and then all of a sudden it starts working, and I don't really know why yet. But you'll see it's quite a fully featured emulator in the browser. You can choose from lots of different kinds of devices you want to emulate. It's not really emulating the actual web view that you get on these different platforms. What it's emulating is the viewport, the size of the device, so you can see how your layout might work across different devices, and that's what Ripple is very useful for. So here I'm seeing that this is the layout for the Nexus Galaxy, but I could change it for an iPad and see what my layout of this application. So,
if I just ask a question? Ripple, it's been going for a while, has it? Because I think that's the project that I used before, but it doesn't look as pretty as that.
Yeah, they've upgraded it to black, so it used to be white.
it was white.
They've subsequently not upgraded the logo from beta. Yeah, which always. A four-year-old project which hasn't graduated from beta.
It's all right. It looked like the thing I'd used before, except.
And as far as so the thing that you used before, I think I've used that, yeah. And it looks identical, but it's white.
Yeah.
That's the only notable difference, as far as I can tell. Okay. I'm sure there's lots of very clever what they're doing. Don't get me wrong.
You're really selling it.
Don't get me wrong. Really clever, and I couldn't build this myself, but it's flaky as hell. So you can choose different platforms. The Ripple platform doesn't just support Apache Cordova; it also supports other web frameworks like WebWorks, BlackBerry 10 WebWorks, and the mobile web is where you can debug mobile web applications using this as well. And it lets you do stuff like you can emulate the accelerometer. That's fancy, isn't it? Look at that. WebGL there, a little bit of WebGL. Or maybe is it 3D CSS? I don't know. So you could put in you could send a shake the phone, for example, and your application might have some accelerometer support in there, and it would activate certain features and stuff like that. You can emulate like the battery level being low, whether or not the phone's plugged in or not. The network settings, the connection type that it has, you can simulate poor connections. Geolocation, if your application relies on maps and it needs to be in specific locations, you can actually you can change the lat long, and also you can simulate I don't know if this is definitely true, but I'm pretty sure that must mean simulating a selection of stops. So like if you want to map a route, this is what the Windows emulator is able to do as well. I'm pretty sure that's the same kind of file, is that you're able to map a route. So for example, you have a person which is at one particular lat long, and then they walk to another lat long, then another lat long, then another lat long, basically going on a journey. And you could play that back to the application and see what your application responds as they move through walking down the street. So if you're building a mapping application, something like that might be useful, or a sat nav application, something like that would be useful to be able to support. And there's the device ready and fire various events which have been fired. Now this is the application that Visual Studio starts with, which confused the hell out of me when I first used it, because it looks like it's a splash screen for the emulator. But that actually is the app. So that's the default app, which is in the file new project, which is really, really confusing, because I spent about 20 or 30 minutes debugging why the app's not starting, to only realize the app started like an idiot. I shouldn't have told you that. You'd never have known. But never mind. So that's the application. And we have... in the actual WW root, something which looks very much like a website. An index.html, like it's 1999. So I can put in a H2 here. Man. It's the web. And we've got an index.js. You can see that we have an anonymous function here. We've got a document add event listener for device ready. You wouldn't get device ready on the web. That is something that the Apache Cordova, it's an event that the Apache Cordova team have kind of added to all of these native web views. So when the device is ready for an app to start, it's going to call the device ready function. And I've got an on device ready function. And what I do is I bind up a couple of, well, I don't, the demo project binds up a pause and a resume button. And then I've got I'm getting an element, device ready, and I'm saying in HTML device ready and class name is ready. So basically it's going to this HTML document, it's connecting to this P tag, and it's changing the class on that P tag. So it's just doing web stuff. Like at this point, all it's doing is JavaScript. I'm linking to a JavaScript file from Cordova. This is what allows me to call Cordova, call some of the native capabilities. I've got a JavaScript file called platform overrides, which we'll come to later. And then the index.js, that's just linking to it. So they've linked here at the bottom of the document, just like you would a web page. It could be anywhere. You'll see this, one of the only things, this is a bit odd. This is a meta tag called content security policy. And there is some, one of the biggest challenges with running applications in this kind of environment is the security questions, the problems and potential issues with security. And Apache Cordova have created models to try and get around some of the requirements of some operating systems. For example, in Windows, you can't just load in a website into a JavaScript application in Windows and then inject HTML. You just can't do that. It stops you doing that. For good reasons, because they don't want you like going to a web view and that web view running code which then starts injecting HTML into the application. It crosses boundary or a cross site scripting attack inside of an application. So there's loads of security things that they've that are problems, which this platform overrides JavaScript function disables or changes, and this meta tag configures it. So you don't need to worry about it. You won't ever, unless you're doing small, unless you start throwing errors about security policies and so forth, you probably won't ever have to investigate it. But that's what those two tags are doing. They're there for kind of making the security stuff easier to work with. We've got an images folder with a Cordova PNG, which is that thing which is on the middle of the screen. We're styling everything in CSS. So it's just HTML, JavaScript, CSS, inside of a web view. That web view's just got capabilities that other web views just don't have. So let's try and do this. I generally, my workflow when I'm on a Windows machine, and if you're using the Visual Studio tools, I find the fastest way to actually get something up and running, and the most reliable way, is to run it as a Windows 10 application. So Android emulators are quite slow, generally, so running on those emulators, you could do, but I only do that when I need to test it on Android. I don't do that like as my part of my workflow. You could use Ripple, but I find it infuriating that I'm constantly having to switch off networks depending on where my location. And I'm sure that there's a configuration somewhere in a firewall that I could change which would stop that happening, but I don't know what it is. So I'm just going to choose Windows x86. That's generally the debugging environment I find easiest to work with. I run it up, and it starts really quick, or relatively quick. So I start that application up again. He says starts really quick. It does takes ages. It is a first build of that. Oh, it's a first build, and actually, I don't have any network. And it's probably going to NPM and all sorts to get stuff, so. Race. Mm-hmm. I knew I shouldn't have dislocated my network.
I've got network on my phone. I'm just going to try and talk everyone to that. I've got 4G. It just actually keeps switching between 4G, 3G, and H plus. But I do actually have a signal. The fact is, obviously, when you're building Apache Cordova applications, your actual applications will work offline. But a lot of the build chain for this Visual Studio stuff and for Apache Cordova and all that stuff relies on NPM. So if you can't get to NPM to download the packages, you're going to be stuffed. but the main advantage of building one of these kind of Apache Cordova applications is being able to take the web and make it work offline. Oh, here we go. Internet's back up. So you can see I've got a blank Cordova application. I've got H2, which says, man, it's the web. I've got a button. I've got I've basically the same application. It's responsive. and I can go in here and experience. I don't know if I can change this, actually. Yeah, you can. So you can edit the DOM live through Visual Studio, and it interacts back into the Windows 10. I think the Windows 10 thing on a Windows machine seems to be the fastest to start, simplest to debug, most reliable in those instances. But your mileage may vary. So if we go to index.html, and we put in something like on device ready, I'm going to add a button. What did I was going to add? Yeah, this one will do. So go in here, and I'll just stick in. BTN. Get picture. So if I just go into my HTML and say button ID equals get picture. BTN on click, and then I'll just put a debug point in there.
Presumably you could use normal add event listener API and things like that.
Yeah, you could write better JavaScript than I'm writing there, definitely. you can use anything which is JavaScript you can use. It's just web views, ultimately. That's important to remember as well. When you're writing, the JavaScript you're writing is ultimately going to be executed inside of a web view at some point. So if you're writing ECMAScript 6 or ECMAScript 7 stuff, it will work on certain phones and it won't work on other phones. So ultimately, you're going to have to think about what devices you want to target and then think about the lowest common denominator, the crappiest browser, and then target that.
Could you
just use Babel?
You could if but I wouldn't. you could use Babel, yeah, absolutely, if you want.
And TypeScript, I'm assuming you can't use TypeScript, have you?
Yeah, absolutely, you can use TypeScript. So anything which, ultimately, this is running JavaScript. So Babel, TypeScript will thing it down. Now, the reason I was just saying about Babel is that it depends what you're using. Like, if you're just using basic stuff, where, like, you just want to use the new fat arrows or something like that, then that's great. But if you want to try and do some of the more complicated stuff, like adding platform features, which has to polyfill, like a promise, for example, when it's doing native promises, some of the stuff in that, in Babel, is not particularly performant.
But at the same time, you can actually include your own polyfills. For instance, the request thing I was on about earlier that I actually released is just basically an AJAX request that works with returning promises.
Yeah.
But I recommend like the ES6 promise library, which is actually available by NPM.
Yep.
And that's very performant for the fact that it is just using a polyfill.
That's the one of the things that I'd be cautious of if you're using a transpiler. Is just like be wary that of what you're transpiling, because you can sometimes just think it will be a panacea of being able to fix all the things.
I think this is the reason why Babel went from 5, when it's like we do everything for you, to 6, where we do nothing for you, and you plug everything in, because we're not actually brilliant at everything.
Well, it's like a 21 year old guy which wrote the whole thing, and he's like, in his own admission, has never written a compiler before. So, like,
yeah, and you did a very good job.
Again, better than I could do. But I'm just saying is that.
Yeah. No, I totally agree. I totally agree with what you're saying. For instance, the promise stuff. For instance, there is better implementations out there. But that's what I thought was quite good about the fact that Babel 6, for instance, and also with TypeScript, which was just mentioned. I can't remember which you said. Yep. Yeah, TypeScript is actually now going towards the ES6 and ES 2017 standards. So it's like they are all pulling in the same direction.
Yeah, ultimately, both those frameworks will not be required in 3 years.
Yes.
But obviously, as we're kind of saying,
yeah,
is that...
Yeah, it'll still be around.
Yeah, as long as... But the cross-platform JavaScript, ultimately, it's a like mobile application, like Cordova applications, you're not having to worry about IE at all. Like you're having the probably the worst thing you're having to do is think about stock Android browsers potentially.
Gingerbread 2.3 was the worst thing that I had to deal with.
Yeah.
It just would not take anything like the idea of everything else took the idea of cookies, for instance. And considering this is actually a web view, you should take cookies, but that just went no.
Yeah. And there's really strange things about like restrictions in how much data you can store in one of them or something
exactly,
like that.
Yeah.
So ultimately, this is the web. You can debug it. I find my workflow, I prefer working in 10, and then when I need to test against Android, I use the emulator for Android, or I'll plug an Android application device actually into my machine and deploy to that. And then the last thing that I'll do is test it on an iPhone, and because it just takes a lot longer to debug over the network and to push it to the network and stuff. You obviously want it to work across all of those things, but you'll find that you commonly work against one device, which is the quickest one to debug and work with, and then you try it later on when you're doing QA.
Given the inconsistencies in web database implementations,
yep,
and Matt's, for example, you say Matt, you can store and detecting how much you can store,
yep,
for example, does Cordova provide API hooks that allow you to hook into native?
Yeah. Precisely, yeah. So you can absolutely get away with those. You can, for most things, get away with, say, local storage or IndexedDB. It's pretty well supported across browser things, but they do have limitations on how much you could store. If you want to store lots of stuff, you might be looking to store that stuff in, say, something like SQLite. And there absolutely are SQLite plugins that you can do, which they install. Basically, when you're interacting with the JavaScript, it's actually storing it inside of something like SQLite on the device. So, yes, absolutely. That's what Cordova's good at. Those bits where the browser implementations are a bit ropey or a bit not perfect, you can switch out and just use native. Whatever they would use natively, you can use ultimately.
So if I wanted to use geolocation,
given
the relative maturity of the HTML5 geolocation API,
yep,
if you were writing the app,
yep,
would you be using the HTML5 geolocation API, or would you be hooking to Cordova?
So Apache Cordova has a plugin, which exposes that, and Apache Cordova make a call as to whether or not they will use the native browser implementation.
Oh, so it'll make the decision for you.
They will, yeah, based upon how well it works, or whether they have to do something native.
So feature detection is
a play. Oh yeah, absolutely. There's a lot of feature detection. It needs to know what platform it's running on, but it needs to know at build what platform it's running on. This isn't doing it necessarily live. So when it produces for iOS, it's producing a plugin for iOS, and that plugin will determine how it actually runs on iOS, whether it's calling into native or it's using the browser features.
Can I just expand on that?
Sure.
I'm thinking about 3.5-ish years ago when I was doing this. At the time, if HTML5 was available on the platforms I was using,
yep,
I just didn't use the Cordova APIs if I didn't want to, but I could actually then bypass all that,
yep,
and just basically just use the HTML5
yeah,
APIs. So you could actually choose to use the APIs.
Oh yeah.
If you just think you're going to use them anyway.
If you just want to use geolock and do exactly the same as you would in browser, you can absolutely do that, and it will work just fine.
So that's still possible.
Oh yeah, of course. Yeah. Anything which works in a browser will just still work. It's just that there are certain platforms where maybe geolock isn't that great. It isn't that great on, I don't know. Actually, it's a bad example because it probably actually is quite mature in browser, and I imagine.
Well, I think it's just like feature testing. What I was doing when I was doing it back in the day, it's like I was still using sort of HTML5 for some of the stuff. In fact, I didn't have Ripple was rubbish there. And
still is.
The other thing, still is. And the Android emulator shit blowed up, and then they haven't tried to exit. So I was literally trying to use HTML5 stuff at the time. And it literally is, you either go through the Cordova API or you do the HTML5 stuff and you pray that it works and you use your tests and stuff.
Okay, cool. So yeah, we'll come back and I'll take some of this thing and actually build an application. But all I wanted to show there at the point before that is So I had a little button I created. I clicked the button.onClick, and I'm calling into navigator.camera.getPicture. One of the things that just to point out here, though, is that GetPicture is an API. This is a Cordova API, and if I run this up, it's going to fail. It's going to say, Elmwood's here, we get a property GetPicture of under 5 null reference. So if I break that, the reason is because that plugin hasn't been enabled. So if I just go over to my config.xml and go to plugins, camera, add that plugin, that will just kind of light up that feature now. So Navigator now has a get picture thing. So camera.getPicture, navigator.camera.getPicture now is an API that I will be able to call. And on success of that, it's gonna do something with that image, and on failure, it's gonna do something with that. So if I just quickly, very quickly, just put a function down here called on success, and I think it has a value which comes over as well, and then I'll do an on fail one as well. On fail, just so I can break into it. And then when I run this up now, hopefully, when I press the button, which doesn't look like a button, it looks like a gray square because I forgot to put a value into it. This button here. It will call into navigator.camera.getPicture. It's then going to call a native UI on Windows, which is going to be the file prompt. And I can select a picture, press open, and then because it's been successful, it comes back, and then I've got the data URI of that image back into my application. Obviously, there's some things I put saved photo album. I could, instead of saved photo album, I can actually call from the camera. I want to make it as a camera call. So if I now run this same application up, instead of trying to get it from my file system, and obviously the file system will be different on each device, I now click the button and it will try and get it from the camera. So I should get some kind of pop-up from my camera. And then I take a picture, save that. Doesn't save it, don't worry. And then I've got that value, which at the moment I just throw away. So that's an example of how I then tie into a device capability. If I put it on Android, however Android deals with photos, it would just do that. I only ever code once, and it just works like that. So what I'm going to do, if we have pizza, come back, I'll show you a more complete application that I built this morning, so hopefully it works, where I will try and capture people's faces in this room and determine the level of happiness in the room based upon your images using this application. So let's have pizza. Yeah, let's have pizza and let's come back to it. Okay.
Okay, it helps out pizza.
Is that surface going to be safe doing that?
All the code for this application I'm going to show you, I will commit to GitHub as soon as I'm done here. But it's not perfect code, but it will just show you. Simply, we can call with Cordova. We build websites, basically. We're building web code, HTML, JavaScript. And if we want to, we can call into device native capabilities. And it means that we can take the web offline. So you can do web stuff offline, and you can use store stuff offline. You can have an application which doesn't require internet at all. The one that I've built does require internet, and it requires internet because I call a machine learning API from Project Oxford. Project Oxford's a vision API which was created, or a series of machine learning APIs which were created in Cambridge by Microsoft Research, and I don't know why they called it Project Oxford, but they did. And it's basically a series of APIs that you can call with either generally with video, text, or images, and it will give you back JSON responses which tells you stuff about that data. And there's all sorts of APIs here. There's face APIs, facial recognition APIs. We've built a ton of different demos on this, so we've got demos which you might have seen take a picture and can determine how old the person in the picture is based upon that image. It can tell you where the face is located inside the picture in the dimensions in terms of the left, right, and how wide the face is and so forth. these are just the basics of what you could do. You could actually use machine learning in your business to detect anything. Anything where you need to find data or patterns in data, you can use machine learning. And we have a full suite of machine learning APIs and systems that you can build machine learning APIs for your own companies. So if, for example, you needed to do fraud detection on credit cards, we have APIs and ways that you can build that stuff. All sorts of things can be done with machine learning, but we have some cool things which are useful. We have speech APIs where you can speak into a microphone, send a WAV file to this service, and it will return the text from that speech. We can also send text to the service, and it will give us a WAV file, which is a person speaking that text. We have things like a spell check API, a video API, which does facial recognition inside of videos. It also can do detection algorithms, so you can send a big, massive video over to it, and it'll tell you where there's been movement in the video, where people have actually moved, and what frames they've moved on. The one that I'm going to look at today is the one called the Emotion API. And what this does is you send it a picture, and then from that picture, it finds the faces in the picture, and it gives you a score of their emotions in that picture. And it's all based upon machine learning. There's no fancy algorithm written by a human. It's a machine that's written this based upon learning. So we've given it a ton of images where we've told what the emotions in those pictures are, and it somehow taught itself, which we don't quite know how it's taught itself. There's no specific function there, but it knows what people's emotions are from photographs now. So on all of these APIs on Project Oxford, there's a live demo page. So if you go into that live demo, you can basically select one of these pictures or upload your own picture, and you will get a JSON response back from it, which basically says, look, we've got an array of faces. There's one face here, and they've got anger, contempt. So that person is happy generally. That person is happy. They're all happy because it's photos, right? This guy is stoned. little young. Starting young. He is, what is his bit overriding emotion? Happiness. It's actually really cool where surprise and happiness is the overriding emotion, but it's actually very good at understanding people's emotion, very subtle emotions in people's faces that you might not expect. So what I've done is I've taken this API and I've built an Ionic application from it. So while I was building an Apache Cordova application before, and I just had some HTML and JavaScript built into it, that's fine. But if you want to construct a bigger application, you might start thinking about frameworks like Angular or like React that you might want to be using. Visual Studio has some really good Ionic templates. So you can say file new. You would be able to say file new if you could use this trackpad on this. File new project. And as well as blank app Apache Cordova, we have an Ionic blank app. We have an Ionic side menu template and an Ionic tabs template. I've taken the Ionic tab template and I've implemented the Oxford API into it. By implementing basically Ionic, there's a view engine which it runs, and it, for the application management, it uses Angular. So if you've done Angular at all on the web, Angular 1, then this will be really familiar to you. If you've not, it's like probably you might want to take a look at if you're building JavaScript applications, because it does make things a lot easier. So I have a number of controllers in my application. One of the controllers, all it does, it's really hackily written, excuse me, but it has a number of functions. One's take a picture, one's select a picture. And what happens is when one of those images, however it got selected or the camera took the picture, it will show a loading thing. It will say the application is loading. I'm going to get an API key. This is my emotion API key. And then I'm going to call this particular endpoint, this API endpoint. And if I go to call API, so I can use go to definition inside of Visual Studio to go to the JavaScript function definition. All this does is it gets the image from my thing. It posts it up to the server. I have to do something here which converts a data URI to a blob, which I found on Stack Overflow. Probably not the most efficient way of doing it, but it works. I basically pass the binary of this file up to this API, and then I get a response which contains all the face data as a JSON request, and then I bind that to my application. I'm basically using the default template of Ionic. And it gives him, just to show you why you might want to use one of these things. If you're building applications, you want it to feel like an application. You don't want people to think, oh, this is a a website. And things like Ionic, but also jQuery Mobile, all sorts of mobile things have these kinds of have systems and techniques built in to make it feel more app-like. So this is a Windows 8 application. So this runs on Windows desktop. But I can deploy this to Windows Phone. I also have that exact same application on Windows Phone. And obviously, I could deploy it to iOS and Android if I wished as well. So I have my application. I've got different tabs on my application. And you'll see if I tab to the results page, it doesn't have any results in it at the moment. But in my account, I've got some information to store my data on the cloud. And I'm using a little toggle button, which is part of Ionic there. It looks like a nice, it feels just like a native control. It doesn't necessarily feel like a web control. What I'm going to do is I'm going to select a picture. I'm going to select an audience from an event we did in Bristol on Thursday. And it will load up that picture. And it's going to fire up that API and ultimately detect all of the faces in that picture. And then it ranks all of the faces that found in that image, ranks 0, 1 to 31 of levels of happiness. So the happiest person was this guy. And you'll see as I'm moving between different sections, you'll note that it's kind of smooth, it's animating like you would expect the application. I've also got things like I can delete things as well if I wish. All built in HTML and CSS, but feels very native app-like because Ionic is such a good platform for doing that sort of thing. So hopefully, rather than adding a picture, if the demo gods are with me, would you be so kind as to like gather in the middle somewhere for me? And I will judge your level of happiness, hopefully. Brightness and lighting conditionings. Dependent. Right. Take a picture. Right, okay. Hopefully.
I'll blink.
Does it do drunk?
Come on.
Or pretending.
Oh.
Bang.
I'll tell you what that is. That was an error. That's an error I know. I'll tell you why it is. Because I try and do a little bit of padding around each face. And the issue is that some of you are too close to the edge of the application. So this is just the quality. All I need to do is just add a little bit of a border around your face. Hold on, we'll be fine. Oh, come on. Right. Sorry about this, guys. I do appreciate this is the flakiest demo in the world. Right. Need a bit of space around everybody. That should be sufficient. Hey. Yes! So, the happiest person is this chap.
Yeah!
That's you. You are the happiest person. You are 100% happy. Zero anger, zero contempt, zero disgust, zero fear.
You know.
No surprise. Who's the saddest? This guy, you're neutral. You again. Last time we demoed this as well, it was you again. What's funny is we did this on Bristol on Thursday, and I took a picture of the whole room, that picture you just took there. And we gave these little edge chargers, these little phone chargers, one to the happiest person, one to the saddest person in the room. But we did it, we took the picture in the morning, and then we did the machine learning demo in the afternoon. The happiest person we gave the charger to, the saddest person left. It's like, oh my God, this actually detected who didn't like my presentation. So, I'm looking at you.
That's neutral at the point,
right? It actually is neutral, yeah. I could sort it by like other things, like who's the angriest, which I don't generally know from this, but most people are happy, which is good, or because they were laughing at my demo. A little bit of sadness there.
A bit of contempt.
But yeah.
I think it was you.
But as we can see, that's kind of how the application will work. How you can take something which is using a device capability like a camera. We're taking that information, we're passing it over to the cloud, then we're displaying it in an application which is probably better than the kind of application I could certainly build in Objective-C. It's animated really well. It's really quite easy to write. I'm just making RESTful calls here. And basically using Apache Cordova, a UI framework like Ionic, and then really cool machine learning APIs. I was able to put that together to this morning from a completely broken machine, repaired the machine, installed all the stalls, built the application in about 3 or 4 hours. And from zero to hero. If I had to try and do that on an Android application and an Objective-C application and a Windows application, there's no way that I would be able to build that today. And that's kind of the value of something like Apache Cordova. So I'm probably going to just leave it there. I was going to walk through the code, but I don't think there's that much. It's web stuff, right? The only things that I've added is a couple of plugins. I will commit this now to GitHub. And if anyone wants to look through the code and so forth, then they're more than welcome to. But I know that we do have a hard stop at 9. So if anyone's got a question, any questions, I'm going to take it. Yeah.
I take it these have all got like a baseline size because you've got the Cordova platform that has to be present for the app to work. Is that one of those type where it's packaged within a...
Yeah, so the resulting file that you actually submit to a store is kind of indistinguishable, I guess, from the... it's a native application, ends up being a native application bundle that contains all of your HTML and JavaScript files, but it's a native application that's actually running.
Oh, okay.
So obviously in that native application, there's some stuff that you didn't write. There's the Cordova abstractions for that particular library. So you will find that the average Cordova application is heavier, say, than if you were just writing. If I was writing the exact same application without Cordova, I'd be able to write a smaller file, a smaller application without using something like Cordova. But that's true of all cross-platform tools, like Xamarin as well. It will produce a much larger file size because it has to add in all of the stuff to make cross-platform stuff work, which you might not be using in your application. So I could write a smaller application if I wrote it natively. But that's one of the sort of the things that you have to give up. Yeah.
What are the main limitations that you can think of? I know there's been instances of companies that have started off with something like this and then moved over to native over time. Why do you think that happens?
I think the problem with it is that it's quite buggy in that it's JavaScript. Like it's inevitably a difficult language to manage, especially on large teams. Although JavaScript is well used and HTML layouts are well used, very few people know how to write JavaScript applications in JavaScript. They know how to write websites, and they sometimes know how to, but there's fewer people which actually know how to write and memory manage like applications in JavaScript. I'm not necessarily one of those people. I know enough JavaScript to survive, but I don't know if I know how to build a really high-performing JavaScript application.
So do you think now with the popularity of things like React and Angular that it's going to become more commonplace for people to stick with this?
Yeah, I think so, yeah. I think there's... it depends, right, what you need it to do. Like, if that's an acceptable... Most line of business applications that I see, that's better. Even that little thing that I built there is a better quality end product than a lot of people are building in line of business world today with on mobile applications. So my view is that, like, for the vast majority of applications, this is good enough. It's when you're trying to compete on quality, that's when it's not going to work for you. Like, if you want to be the best application in a specific category, then you're probably going to want to build native. You're going to have to spend money to make it the best it could possibly be. But if it's just a general purpose application, and I think line of business applications are the biggest, they're the biggest consumers of Apache Cordova. I think something like 13% of all applications in the store are built with Apache Cordova, and I think it's something like 22 in line of business applications. So it's generally more popular in line of business applications. But for obvious reasons, because they want a single code base which is easily manageable and can be built by one team. So I think as we see web views get better and the browsers inside phone devices get better, we see a maturity of tooling around it because the tooling to date has not been great. And also like a convergence around a couple of frameworks. So like Angular, like we've seen Angular in the web become like the framework. Like it needs like Ionic or React or whatever to become the framework. And then this stuff could be really, really important and powerful.
Yeah, well, I suppose Angular 2 is supposed to be mobile first.
Yeah, but at the moment I think we're still in a bit of a in-between stage where we're not quite sure what everyone wants to do. Do we want to stick with web standards? Do we want to divert from that and optimize for performance? What do we want? What do we want to do as a community? I don't think there's a decision being made on that. But in the majority, the vast majority of applications, there's nothing you can't do in Apache Cordova that you can do. It starts to come when you start doing augmented reality. That sort of stuff requires native. It's where native stuff happens to be a problem. But ultimately, you can still build the rest of the application in Cordova, then the little bit that you want, you could write that natively. I mean, you can have a hybrid doesn't have to mean, like, only use web technologies. A hybrid can mean that you use native technologies as well. But you, in a Cordova world, you just use them as plugins.
Yeah. So, if you can build it in 4 hours, is it not beyond the bounds of possibility that people who have adverts put a camera in the advert and judge how people react to adverts as they walk down the street? Certain operating system manufacturers can have cameras collecting data. Using Windows 10 and it's judging how you react.
Yeah, ultimately, all of the capabilities
security,
like
security, there's any number of applications.
Yeah, so in terms of device security, what I'm doing there, when I choose to install an application from an app store, it asks me if I allow allow camera access. So I've already went through that process with this app. When I install it, it says it will first time use. It will say, do you want to allow the camera? And I said yes as a user. So none of the, there's no, like, Apache Cordova doesn't get around of any of the security blockers that you get in regular stores. So you still, the user has to say yes to those things. But in terms of machine learning and mass surveillance, yeah, that's really scary stuff, and they absolutely could do that stuff.
Essentially what I'm saying is if you can do it 4 hours this morning, it's already been done and it's been
the beauty
out
of,
there.
The thing is, though, I built that in 4 hours using a machine learning API, which took probably someone somewhere 50 years of their life of research. But it took me 4 hours to call it because it's a REST API. But those machine learning APIs nowadays are getting really, really powerful. And if I can determine the happiness in the room really simply, it's amazing what other data scientists can do on your Facebook data, on your the information as you walk down an airport. All that stuff could be used to find stuff out about people. And it's quite scary.
Is that person worried that they look so?
Yeah, it can do all sorts, and absolutely machine learning algorithms being used by airports, border control, all sorts of different applications. Some of them really cool, great applications, and some of them probably quite scary, Orwellian applications as well. But yeah.
Did you say all the HTML and JavaScript has to be bundled in the thing?
It doesn't have to be. I have in this instance, that's all local HTML and JavaScript. But you could also use a thing called a hosted web application. There's a concept of a web view as well. So you could, your application actually physically could be a real web application with a server endpoint and URL, and some applications are built using that. We actually have a tool called manifold.js, which basically lets you take a website, you add a manifest to your website, and then Manifold.js will bundle it using Apache Cordova into web stores.
I thought that was Electron.
Electron's used by VS Visual Studio Code.
Yeah.
It uses Cordova to do the packaging for Manifold. Manifold builds for like 5 or 6 different platforms.
Yeah.
And you use Cordova for some of them, and for some of them it doesn't use Cordova.
Oh, you should show people Manifold.js.
I would usually demo it, but I don't really know how to demo it. I'll just
show them the website, because it's amazingly cool.
So the other thing which is quite cool about Manifold.js on Windows is that you can weirdly, from a website, execute any, given the right permissions, any Windows APIs from a website. So you can have an app which is hosted on a website which calls JavaScript. If it's given permission, it can interact with the Windows APIs as well. So Manifold... JS. So I think. So Manifold.js is a command line tool that you can say npm install -manifold.js, and you can create applications, and it runs you through the process of creating them, and it will then generate applications using Cordova for all the different platforms. But the idea of this is that you have a hosted application, and I'm just trying to think of a URL. I do know my friend's got one. Like mental web. I'm hoping Martin can. Damn you. Hold on, let me look at his demo script. Oh, he stores them all on GitHub now. Hybrid apps. His internet connection's not great. Oh, zip! What is he doing zip for? These are usually markdown files. That was a markdown file. There we go, manifold.js. There we go, look at sentimental web, this one. So this is his website, and he goes to manifold.js. He enters a URL, sentimental.web. Probably have to put HTTP there as well. Get started. It takes that website. It looks at that thing, that manifold file, and it says, okay, I know what all the icons for the different files are. And then you can click generate an application. Generate. Generate package. Then it creates a package, and what will download for me is an app for every platform, which I could take to the web store, and install it, and that would be basically a packaged application of that website.
Was there anything special about that website that you picked first of all?
Yeah, the reason I chose that one was because he's done stuff. It could just be a regular website, so it doesn't have to be special at all. But what Martin's done with his website is he's implemented functionality into that website, which will come alive on certain platforms. So if I open that website up in Windows 10, it can do things that it won't do on iOS. It can even install it as an Office JS web application, so I could use this in Office as well. But I can't actually download it at the moment because it's quite big. It's either quite big or it's taking a long time to package. But actually, I might even have, what's it called? Sentimental. Yeah, well, this is good. This is I've got one I've got earlier. So I could say Nottingham is ace. Analyze it. And I've got an internet connection. What Martin's got full access to the Windows, that's a website, but he's calling a Windows API, and he's got full access to the Windows API, and what he decided to do with it was show a pop-up. But that could be anything in the Windows API, I promise you. So it says sentiment score of that particular piece of text was 91, and it says Nottingham is the highlighted key phrase of that. And what should happen with this application as well, it just added in notifications into my application through it. This is a website, just added notifications, and if I had the tile, which I don't, if I had the tile pinned, it would have tiles which were sweeping through the sentimental stuff as well. So that is a bit of a mind melt in that that's an app which is on the web, but it can access APIs, native APIs, because of the way it's built using manifold.js. It's a whole different talk, but thank you very much for reminding about that.
Could you push? I don't know if it's possible. Could you push a message to me about the app over?
Would it not work because the website's closed? Depends if the app's open, the website's open.
Yeah.
So yeah, the website's open, so the communication.
Then. It couldn't push a background message to say.
Yes, it could. Right. So what you'd have is say Signal R on your website.
Yeah.
And I would press a button on my command center to send a Signal R to all open connections.
Yeah.
It would then send to the actual application. The application would invoke a Windows API, which would then notify.
But the application would have to be open on the client.
Of course. Yeah. 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 No, it wouldn't. So the application, we could set the application up on startup to register for notifications, open up a communications channel, and once it's installed, and then we could push regular push notifications to the application, not via the website, but through the application, and then it could show up. So you could do that.
Could that be done on all platforms?
No. So that particular...
That'd just be Windows.
Invoking Windows APIs is just Windows. But on other platforms, you can use Cordova APIs, I believe. But some of the more interesting stuff with manifold.js is only possible on Windows 10. But it is a bit. We do get into the world of. It becomes very confusing very quickly. Ultimately, manifold.js is also built on Apache Cordova for other platforms. For Windows 10, it's not. Doesn't use Cordova, but for other platforms, it does. But you can invoke, and that's really the future. That's potentially the future of the web, which is. Websites which become installable, which then have full access to the device's capabilities. That's the nirvana, right?
Yeah. I'm assuming it's clever enough when, not manifold now, but Cordova, it's clever enough when it's packaged that when you then try and install, say, on Android, it knows what permissions your app's using rather than what it can possibly do.
Precisely, yeah. And you have to request those permissions. So different plugins require different permissions. And so like on the Windows that I'm using the camera, I could switch off the camera permissions for that particular app, and then my camera won't work, right, for example.
And you've got to catch that.
You'll need a catch, which clearly I wrote that in a couple of hours. It's definitely not doing that. It doesn't even detect at the moment if the internet connection's on or off. So it's really, really sketchy. But I will commit that to... I'll do that right now, actually, whilst I remember. Documents, GitHub, how happy. I learned a thing the other day. Didn't know this at all. But if you click on Shift on Windows and then click right-click, you get... open command window here. Did you know that?
And then there's the administrator one that I asked you about.
Oh, was that? Yeah, it was you. That was
me.
I need to discuss this the other day. So you want a thing, just press shift, right click, and then you get open command window here, and then the command window opens, but at that particular pit in the folder. And then what I discovered is, I can't even remember how you do the admin now.
It was Alt F something, wasn't it?
Alt F.
There it is. I think it was.
Alt F M.
There it is.
A. Yeah. Yes, and then it opens up the command prompt.
Right. How do I remember that and you don't?
And then there's another one. There's another one. If I'm in the folder, like this, I can just type in here, CMD.
Oh,
that
cool.
Opens up. Mm. And also, if I'm in the top here, I can just type PowerShell. Mm. Look at that. So if you've learned nothing today, you've learned maybe those things. Right. Those are the big takeaways. Oh, now we're right, let's get on. Windows 10, it does word wrap in the console and transparency. There's a few things that I've got going on in this thing, which is a little bit
just
unusual.
Copy and paste, that's the biggest for me.
So, yeah, copy and paste
just,
works.
That's the excellent thing.
Screen colours, and then I've got this opacity, which I can change to opacity.
Transparency.
And the other thing is, I've got environmental variables. Oh. Environmental variables are here. Inside prompt, I've got this little command here. And there's a whole little syntax that you can use. See the one in prompt? And that basically, for what the behavior that changes, is it prints the whole thing across the top and then puts a new line just underneath it. Rather than having, because if you're working on a really long file name, it's really annoying because you can't see your commands. So yeah, I do those changes. So if you want to customize commands, you can now. What was I going to do? Git push. Oh, I've got no origin. GitHub.com. This is the plague, isn't it, today? Like, my internet's been terrible. Oh, I'll do it when I've got internet. But on that, you are not connected, which has been the highlight. This has been like the kind of... I think that's... A good summary of this talk. Thank you very much for listening for the last 2 hours. Cheers.
Cheers.
Yeah, thanks for coming, everyone. Next month, we've got a guy called Sean Austin talking about Aurelia, which is another JavaScript framework, but I reckon it's the best one. And then the month after, we've got Lightning Talk. So if anyone wants to do a Lightning Talk, please let me know. We've got spaces and we need someone to fill in. Yeah, there's leftover pizza as well if you want to text me. Cheers. See you.
See you.